Okay, it is my pleasure to open this afternoon session. I want to remind you that everything is recorded, including your questions. So everything can be used against you, but nevertheless, Arthur instructed me to encourage you to ask questions. Take the risk of this being used against you. So it is my pleasure to introduce the first speaker, Viktor Ostrick from University of Oregon. He's my collaborator and friend, collaborator in many papers and books. This talk is not an exception, as you can see. And because of this, I have a conflict of interest as when it comes to stopping him if he goes over time. So his talk does not have an upper bound in length. please.
Okay, so thank you very much, Paul. And I want to say thank you to Arthur and to all the organizers of this conference for their hard work. So thanks very much. This is very interesting. I am going to talk about symmetric tensor categories. You will see that real content of my talk is about a case when the symmetric tensor categories are over a field of characteristic P, which might be very unphysical, but hopefully some part of the story is definitely related with physics. So this conference is about connections of physics and mathematics. Well, sometimes physics influences mathematics, and this is kind of case of this. But actually, somewhere in the back of my mind, there is a hope that it's also going to be useful for physics one day. I will have some base field. I'm going to assume that it's algebraically closed, but keep in mind cases of complex numbers or algebraic closure of finite field. I'm going to talk about symmetric tensor categories. I hope that you are not afraid of categories. So let me very briefly remind some things here. So first of all, my categories, they are going to be K-linear, and this is where field plays a role, and they're going to be abelian. So this just means that if you have some morphism, it makes sense to talk about kernel, co-kernel, and things like this. In tensor categories, you have objects, morphisms, like in any category, you have extra operation of tensor product, which is also K-linear, bilinear. You have a specific isomorphism of associativity, so things are associative, but it's kind of, it's not just a property, it's some structure that you have to come up with. Things are commutative in a strong sense, so nothing is braided, it's just symmetric, so when you do it twice, it's identity. Categories are rigid, so this means that everything has duals. Let me just remind basic examples. So kind of one basic example is to take some group, your favorite group, finite group, compact group, maybe algebraic group, this produces us category in usual way. So objects are just finite dimensional representations of this group. Morphisms are intertwiners. Tensor product, objects by definition are vector spaces with some extra structures. So tensor product is kind of usual tensor product of vector spaces. Yeah, that's a good idea. I will write bigger, but with less information. associativity, for tensor product of vector spaces, there is most obvious map you can come up with. So it's obvious. Here, commutativity also, can, when you take tensor product of vector spaces, there is something obvious. Dual, for vector spaces, you have operation of taking dual, and if it's a representation of a group, dual is also a representation of a group. So this is kind of classical example that we know. Another example, which is I think more important for this conference, I think this would be but maybe less familiar to me, is super selection sectors theory. So well uh At the very least, I should mention names of Doplicher, Haag, and Roberts, maybe some other people. Please correct me if I'm wrong. So in this case, well, so it comes from a quantum theory, and in this case, objects are some endomorphisms of algebra of observables. Well, morphisms are again intertwiners, but in completely different sense now, but it's kind of they're still K-linear and so on. So, well. Tensor product is just a composition. So kind of if you have two endomorphisms, you can kind of do one after another. Associativity is actually quite obvious. So when you compose endomorphisms, kind of it's kind of clear when you do three of them, it does not matter in which order you are doing this. So it's kind of still obvious, but in a completely different way. Commutativity is not obvious at all and does not hold always, but this has something to do with space in which we consider our quantum theory. So if dimension of the space is greater or equal than three, then well, very, very roughly speaking, commutativity comes from the fact that if you do a fundamental group of configuration space of points in three-dimensional space, this is just symmetric group. Endpoints in symmetric space. So kind of you basically you think, so this is supposed to represent your theory which describes particles in three-dimensional space. And if you move particles around, then you will kind of, you will see this associativity. Duality is given by, well, I believe it is called conjugate sector. Well, naively it's anti-particles. In our story. So, well, main point of the second example that at least superficially it looks completely different from the first one. I mean, at least it sounds like quite different. And because of this, the following theorem seems, so this theorem is due to Doplicher and Roberts. So they did it in C star setup, and Delin did it kind of a little bit more generally. And all this happened at about the same time, about 1989. It says the following. So let us assume, I'm going to make one assumption, that a characteristic of my field equals to zero. That's important assumption. And then conditions, the following conditions are equivalent for symmetric tensor category, as we just discussed. So one possibility is that, well, so one condition is that for any object X in my category, you can, well, there is n such that exterior power of this x is going to be zero. So exterior power here, if you take a tensor power, nth tensor power of x, there is an action of a symmetric group on this tensor power, just kind of as we discussed before, and you just take image of anti-symmetrizer. So that's one possible condition. Another possible condition is that for any x in C, dimension of X is a non-negative integer. So dimension is something that you can define purely abstractly in setup of tensor categories. You don't need kind of any vector spaces or anything around here. And a priori, this dimension is inside of my base field. So what I wanted to be not just element of my base field, but to be kind of very specific element of my base field, which is non-negative, not specific, but to be non-negative integer. And last condition is that C Well, it's tensor equivalent, so basically it's the same thing as a representation category of some group. Well, this group, this is supposed to be a group in the sense of algebraic geometry. So, well, you should keep in mind just the group. So in the case in this C star case, it's just compact group, or maybe projective limit of compact groups. And more generally, it's affine. It's also compact, yeah. Okay, affine, that's true, group. Okay, so that's kind of wonderful theorem that says that in particular super selection theory, it should be governed by some compact group, which is kind of interesting result by itself. So let me say why the theorem is kind of is not something that we expect right away. So kind of why this is not wow. There is a very, very obvious difficulty if you want to prove this theorem. So this category of representations of group G, it has one little bit of extra structure. So rep G has a forgetful functor. Forgetful functor. Well, from rep G to just to vector spaces. It's very, very silly functor. You take representation and you forget everything except for vector space. So that's kind of, well, what we like to do in mathematics. And for example, this second type of category, I mean, there is nothing obvious of this type right here. So somehow you have to come up with this. Well, in the end of the proof of the theorem, you have this. Yeah. No, yeah, I will tell you about fermionic version very soon. Sense. Yes.
The second condition, how do you know that it's not a non-prime? In the second condition, how do you know this?
The second condition, how do you know it is not an algebra, finite dimensional?
I don't know this. I mean, but I kind of conclusion of the theorem that in particular, if it happens to be a Hopf algebra, it's still equivalent to some representation category of some group. But remember that my categories are symmetric. So it's so kind of if it is Hopf algebra, it is supposed to be triangular or something like this. See, symmetric is very important. Not just even braided, it's symmetric. It's part of the story, very important part of the story. So so and actually conversely, basically this forgetful functor is really thing we are looking for if we want to prove the theorem. So this is something kind of quite classical, something that is called Tanakian theory, and it says that if well, in symmetric tensor category as before, we have F which is from C to vector spaces. I would like this to be symmetric tensor and exact functor. So exact means that any short exact sequence is going to be sent to short exact sequence. Then C is equivalent to representations of some group G. Actually, this group G is really easy to say what it is. It's just kind of automorphism group of this functor. So basically, main difficulty in the theorem is to prove that this functor is somewhere there. So that's kind of what I want to say. So I want to state one more theorem of similar type, but kind of even more general. And for this, I need to introduce a couple more notions. This is notion of moderate growth. So let us take category of this type. Let us take some object, and let us take It's tensor powers, so raised at various tensor powers. But remember, I said that we are doing things in abelian category. So when you do tensor power, you are getting some object of abelian category, and you can find length of its Jordan-Gölder series. So how many simple subquotients are there? And I would like this to be bounded by some geometric progression. So there is some number which depends on my object, some real number, and I just don't want this to grow too fast. So moderate growth, it does not grow too fast. So this is one notion. So just a silly example. So if you take for X something like super vector space of dimension 2, 3, then you can take for this AX number 5. So it's not quite dimension, but kind of you have to know the science and things like this. Okay, so this one useful for me notion, and another useful notion is notion of. You can't make mistake. Whoever is going to speak after me, beware. sure functors. So this is some generalization of exterior powers. So for example, symmetric powers are sure functors. So what you do, you start with lambda, which is Young diagram. Then you take x raised to power n. Symmetric group of size n is going to act on this guy. Well, let us multiply it by representation of symmetric group, which corresponds exactly to this DeYoung diagram. Well, on this object of my category, I have action of my symmetric group and take invariance. Other way to say it, I mean, take this tensor power and take isotypic component, which corresponds to this particular representation of symmetric group. So this is called S lambda of X. Okay, so now I'm ready to state next theorem. Oops. Ah. So this is theorem by Deligne about 2002. Again, I am going to make the same assumption. Characteristic of base field is zero, and then conditions are equivalent. So one condition is that C is of moderate growth. Another condition is that for any X in C, there exists a sure functor S lambda such that S lambda of X equals to zero. So it might be not exterior power, but something else. One more most interesting equivalent condition says that there is a symmetric tensor functor, exact tensor functor from C to category of super vector spaces. And by extension of Tanakian theory, this means that my C has something to do with representations of supergroups. So this G here is now, well, supergroup, which means kind of the same thing as before. Supergroup in the sense of algebraic geometry. So I should say something like affine supergroup scheme. And this epsilon, this is a kind of some minor detail, which I don't want to explain right now, but it's really not very big deal. So essentially it says that everything reduces to study of supergroups. Okay. Well, now main point of my talk is that all this theorems, they do not work in positive characteristic. About 1992, Gelfand, Sergei Gelfand, And David Kazhdan, and also Georgiev and Mathieu. Well, they constructed many counterexamples to both of the theorems. If a characteristic is positive. And well, this is actually exactly the place. They were very much motivated by physics. So this counterexample, they came from actually, in particular, Gelfand and Kazhdan, they were interested in constructing at that time very new quantum invariants of three manifolds. And they wanted to construct braided categories in characteristic zero. But they just noticed that in characteristic P, you also get something and happens to be counterexample to something. And well, I don't think they were interested too much about this, but it's a useful thing. And this is kind of where physics enters into the story. So, well, let me just give you some idea about simplest counterexample. So you can take P to be five, and there is some that we call Fibonacci category, which might be familiar to some people doing other things. And this is category which has just two simple objects, one and x. It's semi-simple, so everything is just direct sum of these guys. And x tensor x happens to be one direct sum of one plus x. So in this category, it's very easy to see that it is of moderate growth. So for example, L of if you take this particular x, its length of tensor power is going to be precise the Fibonacci number. It's really easy to see that some Schur functor is going to annihilate this x, for example, force exterior power is going to work. So it satisfies all these assumptions. And it's semi-simple, so everything is very nice. Definitely, there is no functor in anything like vector spaces or super vector spaces, because if you try to compute dimension of vector space or super vector space, you need to solve equation d squared equals to 1 plus d. It just has no integer solution, so that's too bad. So that's a definite counterexample. And well, together with counterexamples, well, they constructed many of them. So let me describe some of their counterexamples, which we call Verlinde categories. So they are defined for every prime number p, and they're defined in characteristic p. So these categories are defined by some construction which involves some maybe tilting modules over algebraic group SL2, and then you are doing semi-simplification, or you can do semi-simplification of something else. Let me describe just a final answer a little bit. So what you have is exactly P minus one simple objects, L1, L2, LP minus one. Everything is semi-simple, so category, any object of this category is direct sum of these guys. And tensor product is given by familiar formula. So what you will have is a sum over K, which starts with minimum starts maybe with zero, LA minus J plus one plus K, and you end at minimum of IJ P minus I P minus J. I know that it's very small letters. So main point about this formula, it's familiar formula. It's kind of its formula which appears in Verlinde ring, which is kind of, well,
it starts from one. And 2k minus 1, I minus j plus 2k minus 1.
Okay, there are better experts than me here, so this formula is wrong, but it's supposed to be isomorphic to some very famous formula. Okay. Here is kind of our main result. So main point is that, well, you can have something similar to the theorems, but you give up vector spaces or super vector spaces. Keep this Verlinda category. So this Verlinda category is going to replace for you vector spaces and super vector spaces. So let me try to make a statement. So let me just get prepared for a second. So I need well, somewhere in my title there is this notion of Frobenius exact. So let me explain this. Frobenius exact. I will give you one possible definition. So well, if you have some morphism in your category from unit object to some other object X, and this happens to be non-zero, then what you can do, you can take one. It's the same thing as its own symmetric power. So when you take, you know, symmetric powers of one-dimensional vector space, you're always getting one-dimensional vector space. But this maps into symmetric power of X, just because taking symmetric power is a functor. I want this also to be non-zero. It sounds like, I mean, how it can be not true, but surprisingly, we have counterexamples. Actually, these counterexamples are not easy to come up with, but it's not always the case. So it's non-trivial condition. Well, luckily, this non-trivial condition, sometimes there is nothing to check. So this is automatic if C happens to be semi-simple. And you might be interested only in semi-simple ones. Why not? It's still interesting case. Okay. So now, now I should be ready. So maybe something that is easy. Something that is kind of relatively easy to see from my definitions and all this. So assume that we have functor F from C to this Verlinda category as defined here. So really important thing that to something semi-simple, there's finitely many simple objects, something like this. So this is supposed to be functor of the same type as before. So it's symmetric, a tensor, and exact functor. So just of the same type as appeared in my previous theorems. Then, things which are easy to see is that C is of moderate growth. And there is one more thing. So for any X in C, I will explain in a second. Alternating power of this X equals to zero for some N, which depends on X. So a n of x, well, I want it's again to be just an image of antisymmetrizer. So the only thing which I don't want to do, maybe you get used to the fact that in antisymmetrizer you divide by the order of the group by n factorial. I don't want to divide by n factorial because it might be zero in characteristic p. So just take this sum in antisymmetrizer, don't divide by n factorial. So image of sum negative one power pi pi, and pi runs over symmetric group S. Okay, so now theorem. So I'm going to assume that characteristic of my field is now positive, and I'm going to assume that C is Frobenius exact in the sense of this definition. So well, and then a claim is that conditions are equivalent. So one condition, well, C is of moderate growth. Another condition, well, it's about this alternating powers. So for any X, there is N such that alternating power of X equals to zero. And last condition is that you will have really functor to this Verlinda category. So there exists symmetric tensor exact functor f from C to exactly to this Verlinda critical. And now you can do some things. So for example, you can say that this category is probably equivalent to representations of some group, but inside of this category and so on. But since my time is up, so let me stop now. Thank you very much for attention.
So any questions?
In the duplicate robot case, they are in the C star setting, and then they prove that the dimension is an integer. I wonder, what is it possible to carry some part of the star structure, and then in more general context, and so to use their methods?
So my understanding is that you want to skip this assumption about integer dimension.
Yes, yes? Because they proved it.
Yes, so, well, they proved this because, well, if dimension is not integer, you can take various exterior powers of your object, and dimension is given by usual formula. And just by looking at this formula, you will see that at some moment you'll get negative numbers. And this is kind of too bad for C star setup. So that's kind of, well, but on the other hand, you can drop this assumption, and we kind of love to do it. And you can drop this assumption about moderate. I mean, it's more or less, well, according to the theorem, it's more or less the same as to drop assumption about moderate growth and so on. So what you will get is what is called the Lynch category. The Lynch category. There are many examples. There is no kind of general understanding, general structure theory or anything like this. It's very interesting thing. I think Pavel said that some people in physics started getting interested in this, but it's not used too much in physics at this moment, as far as I know.
My question is related to this P.
Uh-huh.
P is very, very large.
Yes.
But you consider some finite category,
mm-hmm.
like this example. Then whether this category, or whether your result can be became the same as the P equals to zero case. Basically, that's it. Whether this sense is true, that finite category from P and P equals to some sense equivalent.
Mm-hmm. This is a very good question. I don't know. Maybe
some structures which
go to the microphone.
I mean, definitely there are some structures that if you define them in characteristic P, then they kind of for large P, they kind of stop depending on P very much, and they behave the same way as in characteristic zero.
Whether this is always true for say, for any given finite category, when you get bigger, then this is always saturated somehow.
Well, I mean, these categories were P. If P goes to infinity, you should think about it that it converges to representations of SU2.
Oh.
So this is a characteristic P version of representations of SU2.
Okay.
Yeah, one good thing about this particular chair is that he will answer questions for you. So.
Yeah, other questions.
Yeah, here. So just want to finish your sentence. So
please hold your mic.
Oh, sorry. Zheng Han Wang. So the functor F, if you take all the natural transformation, is that the same thing as some group in your category?
Yes. I mean, if you do it right, if you do it kind of so you should take kind of automorphism of this functor, yeah. But again, in a sense of algebraic geometry. So you basically have very similar issues when you think about supervector spaces. You should do it right. If you do it right, you'll get some group scheme in this category.
Okay. So then I also confused about this condition of integer quantum dimension. So
mm-hmm.
Are you saying that if this category has a fermion, the quantum dimension has to be non-integer for some cases?
No. I'm saying that it should be negative sometimes. Yes. So basically, if you take representations of some super Lie algebra or something like this, at some moment you should see negative dimension. So
okay. So I think
It's not just z. It's z greater than zero. That's, I mean, it's positive. Positive is more important than integer.
Well, I think I know now. You know, we have a counting example, but it's a braided category. Now you tell me it cannot be narrow. It can never be symmetric. So that's what yes. subtlety. Now you say that the fermion you can have to be negative.
Yes. Okay. So I you did not ask this, but let me say it. At this moment, we don't even hope that something like this holds in braided setup. So maybe this theorem, this second theorem, I would say it. So for me, it's expression. So when people from physics tell that in if space has dimension 3 or higher, then possible particles are bosons and fermions, it's exactly this theorem up here. For me, that's kind of what I have in mind. So basically, it says that if you break symmetry enough, you see bosons and fermions, and that's it. And for anions, for braided categories, there are so many of them, and they're kind of incompatible between each other. It's kind of completely different story. I don't know why. Okay.
Other questions?
Yes, other questions? Okay, let us thank the speaker again.
Thank you.